Good morning. Welcome to worship. It's so good to see all of you, especially those of you who are wearing your floral shirts in support of Mitch Scott, who, if you didn't know, was in a motorcycle accident on Memorial Day. We're praying for his recovery. Thank you to those who wore floral shirts this morning. I gave very strict instructions that the best way to honor him was with Hawaiian shirts, and some of you chose to wear cardinal shirts. And I know Mitch loves the Cardinals, but I gave very strict instructions because it's also my last Sunday. I thought I should have some say. So for the two of you I saw that did that, thanks a lot. So glad that you've joined us this morning. The most important thing that we're going to do today is to worship and humble ourselves and bow down before the God who was, who is, who is yet to come, the God and Lord Jesus who loves the church more than we could ever fathom, who is the head of the church and has control over all of this. And it's in him that we trust. If you're ready to worship that kind of God, would you say amen?
Amen.
Let's stand together as you are able. We're going to sing "And Can It Be?" And if you don't remember, this is my favorite hymn. So even if you don't like it, sing it out for me.
please join me in the call to worship. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. Pray with me. Lord, the eyes of all look to you in hope, and you give them what they need. You open your hand and satisfy the hunger and thirst of all living things. We too turn to you this morning, longing to be filled, to eat of the bread of life, to drink from your life-giving streams, to taste your goodness and live. May this time we spend together in your presence nourish our hearts and minds. May it strengthen our relationship with you and renew our commitment to live in this world as your faithful disciples. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. If you would, take out your GPS, your Grow, Pray, and Study Guide. Today, following worship, we will have a meal and celebration to follow in the Family Life Center. Please come and join us there. And then Thursday the 8th, we need some strawberry stemmers. So the Family Life Center will be booming that morning at 8 a.m. Bring a hat, bowl, paring knife, and a friend. All help will be greatly appreciated. And please remember that next Sunday there will be no worship because we will be covering our shift at the Turkey Festival. But there will be a video on YouTube later on for you to view at your convenience. And then I have one last announcement. An account has been established at the First National Bank in Tremont to help Mitch Scott and his family with expenses that they are incurring as the result of his accident. Deposits may be made at the branches or mailed to Tremont First National Bank, P.O. Box 23, and checks can be made to the Mitch Scott Benefit Fund. And thank you in advance for showing Mitch how much you care for him. As we move into our time of offering, I want to thank you for however you give to the life of the church and for honoring God with your stewardship. I would ask the stewards to move among us now. pray with me. Almighty and generous God, we give these offerings in gratitude for all you have given to us. We give in faith, trusting you will provide for all our needs. We give in love, assured that you can multiply and use them to spread your love in this world. Receive these gifts, tithes, and love offerings. Bless the gift as well as the giver for the growth of your kingdom. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. Sorry. I was thinking. It happens on occasion. I would ask all the children to come down and surround Pastor Larry. He has a message for you.
Holy smokes. Glad I got new yarn. Okay. When you get the yarn, I want you to take a piece and hold it in one hand and then toss it back to me with the other, okay? Or someone else. Okay. Keep a piece from the top. Grab right there. Grab right there. And then toss it back to me. See? Okay. Cool. Groovy. Oh. That one wasn't so groovy. Now we have two different streams going. That's okay. Hold a piece of that. Hold it right there. Got it? Go down with it. And more. Everybody grab a piece of it. Don't let go. Okay, now we're going to go back this way. Grab a piece. Who doesn't have a piece? Hazel? Okay. Jackie? Grab a piece. Grab a piece. Okay? Grab a piece. Got it? Okay. Okay, what have we done? What have we done? Now you've dropped it. What did we make? What? Yarn art, yes. We made a big web, right? And we're all kind of connected to each other through it, right? The person you threw it back to or on there. Jesus said in John chapter 15, I am the vine, you are the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And here's what I think that means for us today. After today, I won't be your pastor anymore. You won't see me on Sunday mornings, but you've got Pastor Jackie, Pastor Andy's coming, and he's awesome. We won't see each other in church anymore, but because we're connected to Jesus, he's the vine, we're the branches, we'll always be connected. We'll always be friends, and we'll always share together in the love of Jesus. Isn't that cool? That's the best thing that I know, is that because of Jesus, we're all connected. Because of his love, we're always, always, always connected. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for this connection that we have because of Jesus. Bind us together. I pray for these young ones. They gather here and in the midst of transition that some can understand, some can't. I pray that you would hold us all in your love, connected to the vine that is Jesus. Help us to always be in love with him and in friendship with one another. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Love you guys. See ya. All right, you got to let go of it. Not very well. It's not going to be easy to put it back together. While I continue putting that together, we're going to sing our next hymn.
Thank you.
As we enter our time of prayer, I would ask you to take out your GPS again, and in the center there, find the prayer list of these people on our prayer list. Hold them in your hand today as we pray for them, and then put your GPS in a place that can remind you to lift them up throughout the week and let them know that you are thinking about them and take them to the Lord. We will start this morning with a moment of silence to center ourselves in prayer. Just breathe in. Breathe in the Holy Spirit and exhale and let go of the many things that are on your mind. Share your burdens and your fears and your frustrations with God. Breathe in the Holy Spirit and let's go to the Lord in silence. God of love and power, hear our prayers as we raise our thoughts and voice to you. We give you thanks for those who are cheerful and bring joy to our lives. We give you thanks for those who are loving and share kindness to others. We give you thanks for those who serve you and help to lead us on our journey of faith. We give you thanks for the earth and its bounty and the splendor of your creation. We lift to you today our prayer concerns, some spoken and many unspoken, Lord. Our friends, family, and each of these on our prayer list, we ask, Lord, that you would surround each one. Those battling with physical and emotional illness, those dealing with everyday life challenges and in need of your healing strength. Lord, today especially be with Mitch as he recuperates from his injuries, and be with his family and let them know that you were right there, right beside them. Lord, bring comfort to those struggling with illness and surround the exhausted caregivers with your perfect calm. You know exactly what each one of us need. Grant wisdom to those who need answers to some difficult questions. And Lord, surround all those who are grieving the loss of someone that they love, that they would feel the comfort of your love as you walk right beside them through their grief. We pray for all pastors during this time of transition. Be with Pastor Rose and her health, and we ask today for safe travel and smooth transitions for Pastor Andy and his family, and Pastor Larry, and Brittany, and Marky, and Sayla, and baby Evie. And surround each one as we adjust to change and continue to work together as your church, Lord, full of disciples for your kingdom. We give you praise for all that you are to us as we pray your prayer, the prayer you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Every child.
have been several Sundays over the last 5 years that I've said, as service ended early, I reserve the balance of my time for a future sermon. Today is that future sermon. Our scripture reading is from James chapter 4, verses 13 to 17. Look here, you who say, today or tomorrow we're going to a certain town and we'll stay there a year. We will do business there and make a profit. How do you know what your life will be like tomorrow? Your life is like the morning fog. It's here a little while, then it's gone. What you ought to say is, if the Lord wants us to, we will live and do this or that. Otherwise, you are boasting about your own pretentious plans, and all such boasting is evil. Remember, it is sin to know what you ought to do and then not to do it. This is God's word, and it is true. Let all who believe say amen. Amen. Pray with me. Lord, for 182 Sundays, you filled me with your Spirit so that I might proclaim the gospel of Jesus. And I pray for the 183rd time that you would empty me of myself, of my conflicted and warring emotions, and that you would speak through me or in spite of me once again. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, God, who is our strength and our Redeemer. For it's in the name of Christ that we pray. Amen. So for a good while now, we've been living in two worlds. On the one hand, we've been living in a giant pile of boxes and purging and throwing stuff away and selling stuff. And if I get one more cut on my body from a cardboard box, I just might scream. On the other hand, we've got this brand new house in Florida waiting for us that we've been trying to figure out from a distance. Like how to set the sprinkler timer from Illinois so we don't get in trouble with the police before we even get there. And buying new furniture and window treatments and imagining how things are going to look in a house that to this point I'm the only one who set foot inside of. Poor Brittany. My mentor, George, has the keys to our house, and he's been coordinating furniture deliveries and all sorts of stuff, and he texted me the other day with this picture and said, "This is my place until you get here." I'm starting to think it's going to be harder to get him out than it was in. We've done our best to live in both worlds, to plan for what's next and do what's necessary while soaking up every last moment with you all. We've planned for the drive down, we've coordinated movers and going away parties and so on and so on. And yet, while we try our best to coordinate for no collisions or conflicts by planning ahead, they happen. No matter how meticulous or detailed our planning is, life happens and our best laid plans go to waste. We can all do our best to coordinate for a perfect tomorrow, but eventually our plans collide with what life throws at us. And I think we can probably all relate to the moments in life where our best planning doesn't quite pan out. Whether it's family schedules for the week or future plans for your life, we've all experienced having one thing mapped out, but life takes you in a completely different direction. Our best planning doesn't always work due to both things that are in our control and things that are beyond our control. And I'll be the first to admit, when I get thrown off, when plans that I've made don't pan out, in the midst of that craziness, I'd be lying if I told you that I've taken it all in stride with a smile on my face. There have been moments when I've been frustrated and took on a pretty poor attitude with those around me, not because anything was seriously wrong, but only because my plans didn't work out. For me, and maybe for you, the reason I get so out of it when plans derail is because it's a reminder that control is an illusion. Think about it. Control is an illusion. A big reason we plan, aside from just being organized, which is a good thing, we plan for security. We like having the security of knowing what the coming days and weeks and months will look like. When we get some security and assurance in what our lives might look like, we wrongfully and automatically begin to assume that we have control. This can be control over our day, or over the next week, or over the next 5 years, whatever we're looking at that moment. So when plans fall through, the control that we thought we had disappears, and we learn that it was an illusion. We feel a little bit shaken or insecure, and we discover that our desire of planning that assumes control collides with the imperfection and unpredictability of life. We can't change life being unpredictable, but we can find hope and some insight in a couple of passages of Scripture that we're going to talk about today that help us discover something deeper about planning for tomorrow that can free us from the need to control everything. Over the last couple of months, we've been in a series called 167, Faith for Everyday Life, from the book of James. We've been slowly walking through this book, and the goal of this series has been to use the teachings of James as an inspiration for how we can practically live out our faith the 167 hours of the week that we're not gathered in church. And if you've been around a while, you know that I plan out the message series about 6 months at a time. So back in November, before we knew any of this would be happening, I was praying and planning for this series in June, and I found these practical bits of advice from James to be the right essence for my last series with you. And as only God could orchestrate, we come to the topic of tomorrow, as we both, pastor and congregation, plan for a tomorrow without one another. And when it comes to tomorrow, James has some strong and interesting things to say. Before I get into those details, it's important to realize the big picture of what James is focusing on. He's not talking about how we can plan for tomorrow better. He's not offering some new time management app. There's about a million of them. James's concern here isn't how we're going to plan for tomorrow. His concern is what we're focusing on as security, as assurance, when it comes to planning for tomorrow. James is not focused on the method of planning, but rather the mindset of our planning when it comes to God's power and control. When we consider the story of James, it makes sense why he would focus on an entirely different mindset when it comes to planning. If you haven't been here through the early weeks of this series, you might not know that James is the half-brother of Jesus, and he has his own transformation story. He went from someone who was skeptical about his brother's ministry at best and outright opposed to his ministry at worst. And he went from that to someone who was the leader, an all-in leader in the early church in Jerusalem. James saw life with two completely different perspectives throughout his years. And I'd be willing to bet that his teaching here comes from his own personal experience when it comes to planning. My brother is not the Messiah. My brother's the Messiah. Control, assumptions, illusion. In fact, I don't think that James is anti-planning here at all. So sorry to all of you who are just go-with-the-flow type of people. James is not telling you to ditch your calendar. You still need it. You drive those of us with calendars crazy. He's encouraging Christ followers to plan with God first in our minds before any details of plans. So let's look again at how he begins this passage. Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business, and make money. Why, you don't even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. He starts off with two words that are meant to be attention grabbers. Now listen. In our world today, it probably doesn't pack a whole lot of punch to say that, but in his day, that was a big deal to say. It was basically James saying, you all have to listen now, because what I'm going to say is really important. It's a trumpet that plays before a big announcement. It's the alarm going off early in the morning to get your attention. He really wanted his listeners to know these next few sentences were important. Now listen. And he speaks to those who say, today or tomorrow we'll go to this city or that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. He's probably talking to traders and local merchants who are looking to build wealth by traveling. Notice what a great business plan is included in their statement. They've got the time, today or tomorrow. They've got the location, we'll go to this or that city. They've got their itinerary, we'll spend a year there and carry on business. And they've got their goal, we're going to make a lot of money. From a business perspective, it sounds okay. If you watch Shark Tank, I think at least Mark Cuban would be interested. It has all of the things that a good business plan would want. But while this might be an okay business model, it's not necessarily a great life model. It's got a lot in there, but one really apparent thing is missing from this somewhat what they assume to be foolproof equation that they're pitching. God is nowhere to be found. There's no acknowledgement of God in it. The mindset of the people saying this are saying, if it's going to be, it's going to be up to me. They're going to be the ones to do everything to get rich and stay wealthy. It was their own effort that would give them safety and security, not God. The people saying this had put all of their stock into their own effort securing them, and if they were honest, it's really beyond their control. It's true for us, too. We can only do so much when the unpredictability of life collides with our own self-reliance. Just ask Blockbuster. Humor me for a minute. I was born in the 80s. Let's talk about Blockbuster. I got a picture of it. Who remembers Blockbuster video stores? Okay. If you're in middle school, Google it. I know you haven't seen one. It was this magical place that we used to have to go to rent movies. There was no streaming. There was no Netflix. There was none of that. We had to walk into a store, rent a tape that the person before us probably didn't rewind. Again, Google it, and you can find out what rewind is. And then we would go home and we would watch the tape and then we would take it back. Okay? Blockbuster had a creative and innovative business model. In 2005, they had just under 6,000 stores. Then they had this new opportunity. They were given the opportunity to purchase a new upstart company called Netflix. They had the opportunity to purchase Netflix for $50 million. Today, Netflix is worth $174 billion, but who's counting? They passed on the opportunity. 5 years later, Netflix took off. Blockbuster was down to 4,000 stores. By early 2015, they had 38 stores. And today, one. The last Blockbuster. Talk about a franchise that had a good business model. They had assumed security in 2005, only to have absolutely nothing left 10 years later. Control's an illusion. I'm not saying that Blockbuster would have survived if they would have prayed before their board meetings and invited God to lead them. Who knows? Maybe they tried that. All I'm saying is that the idea that our own effort and work can secure for us a good tomorrow is not guaranteed. We have to look to something, and in this case, someone bigger than ourselves. That's why James pushes back on the idea. You don't even know what will happen tomorrow. And he says their life is a mist. The comparison to our lives being like a mist takes on two different tones here. James wants us to understand a couple of things. The first thing he wants for us is to know who we are. Our lives are fragile. They can disappear in a moment. I don't say that to be morbid. I say it to be honest. When we look around, so much of our world is built around denying the fragility of life. We dread getting older. We do everything we can to stop it. The last time I checked, the mortality rate is still 100%. No matter how much anti-aging cream or Rogaine you use. James wants us to understand that life is fragile. It's precious, that we ultimately don't have control. The second thing he wants for us to know is the importance of doing what we can today. We become so obsessed with tomorrow. When we understand who we are and that our lives are like a mist, we can begin to better live into who God created us to be. James says that it appears for a little while, and then it vanishes. What are we doing with our lives during the time that they appear for a little while on this earth. We only get one chance at life on this earth. And God created you in such a way to live life on purpose. Your life matters to God. It matters to those around you. Make the most of it now because you never know what will happen next. Tomorrow is not guaranteed, and we live at the mercy and in the hands of God and at the fate of the world. With this truth in mind, James gives clear instructions for what we should do instead. Verse 15, he says, instead you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. Notice the difference in the mindset versus the other one. Not only is God in this plan, but the plan starts with God. If it is the Lord's will, then we'll do that. It took me years to understand that. One of my freshman ministry classes, J.K. Jones was the professor, and he would end the class reminding us the next time we were supposed to be together, and say it was a Wednesday, he would say, if the Lord tarries, I'll see you on Wednesday. I thought, what a weird thing. Of course we'll be here Wednesday. Of course, I was 19 years old and didn't understand the fragility of life. If the Lord wills it, then we'll do this. God is at the front and center of that mindset, and James invites us to seek His will, to seek what God wants for our lives. James is pushing on us not to just have God as a consultant for some of the decisions of my life, but to be the author of everything in my life. Where have you made God a consultant instead of an author? I know I've done it far too often. Seeking God's will is bigger than what job do I have, what car do I drive. It's having God at the center of it all. God cares about your job. God cares about what you're driving. But bigger than that, He cares about your entire life. And His desire is to be at the center of it. And it's not a desire that's out of arrogance, but it's to be lovingly united with the creation that He loves. Who better to have at the center of your life than the one that can provide true assurance and security? It's a security that's bigger than anything that you could do on your own. It's a surer foundation than anything that the world can offer. Trusting in God's will for all of your tomorrows is the best and the most secure thing that you can do for tomorrow. We don't know what tomorrow holds, but we know who holds tomorrow. With this mindset, we can boast in who God is and not in who we are. James makes it clear how this boasting about ourselves doesn't honor God. Verses 16 and 17, he said, as it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. James is referring back to that first statement from the merchants and sellers about the plans they were going to make for their own life. Some commentaries say that within this plan, there was an implied scheming to cheat people out of money so that the merchants could get richer quicker. And obviously, James saw this as being a huge evil and wrong if they were going to steal from others to get rich and then brag about their own accomplishments. But there's another sin present in this text, too. It's the sin that focuses on our planning for tomorrow. Theologian Scott McKnight describes it as the sin of presumption. It's the sin of assuming that our own knowledge, our own success will fall into place perfectly and control tomorrow. It's the sin of presumption that James argues against. It's not the sin of planning, the sin of presumption and assuming that our plans will yield ultimate control. Back in the Gospels, Jesus shares a parable that emphasizes a similar idea of putting our faith and security in the wrong things. And before saying this parable, Jesus warned the people to be on guard from greed and that it is more than just accumulating possessions. And then he tells the crowd a parable about a man known as the rich fool. It's a great title to have. He says this, "The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, 'What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops.' Then he said, 'This is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself?' This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich toward God. You see, the rich fool was missing something. Even with all of his possessions, his bigger barns, the presumption of security, he had lots of things, but he was missing the main thing. He didn't care about God. He didn't care about others. He was only focused on himself. His narcissistic worldview trapped him. It was all about more and more possessions, more and more security for himself. The man wanted more from God, not more of God. He was relying on more things to fulfill him, but what was missing was more of God to fulfill him. He forgot that what he and all of us have is ultimately on loan from God. Even our lives that James says are a mist. It doesn't stay with us. It ultimately goes back to him. There's a story I love about this, about the game of Monopoly. I've probably shared it before. About a young man who would often play Monopoly with his grandmother, and she was phenomenal. Her expertise on the board gave her a huge advantage. She would win every single time. Most of the time, it wouldn't even be close. I'm not sure that I've ever actually finished a game of Monopoly, because it usually ended with my sister and I throwing pieces at one another. But Grandma was so good that she would win the whole game. This kid was done losing to Grandma. He was finally ready to take her on. So he practiced and practiced and learned the game with a friend, and he faced his grandmother again, and this time the tables were turned, and he won. And it might have only been one win among many victories, but it was party time after taking Grandma down. As he danced around the room, Grandma sat calmly and gave him the most important life lesson he could get from the game of Monopoly. She said, "Son, it all goes back in the box when the game's over." All his money, all his hotels, all of his property, yes, even Boardwalk and Park Place, they go back into the box. And when James says your life is but a mist, guess what? It all goes back in the box. The good news is we have another choice. There's another option. It's an option that's collision-proof, even if our plans don't go the way that we think or hope, because we can't put all of our planning and our hope and our trust into temporary things, possessions or wealth or our own effort or abilities or how attractive we are, whatever it is. They give us the control, the illusion of control, but they'll never pan out in the end. The good news is that planning for tomorrow begins with surrendering today. How do we plan for tomorrow? We surrender today. It's not just a surrendering to any person, place, thing, or idea. It's surrendering to God, the Lord of the universe. He's the one that holds tomorrow in his hands, and the one who we can put our trust in, the one who won't let us down, even when everything else seems to be falling apart. Can we still plan? Absolutely. But instead of leaving God out of the equation, we start with him and saying, if it is the Lord's will. Surrender is always involved in discovering God's will for our lives. We can't follow his lead unless we get behind him. The act of surrender means giving up our own effort, our own need to control, and looking to God instead. I can never know God's plan for my life if I'm too busy running it myself. So take a moment for honest reflection. Don't answer for your neighbor, answer these for yourself. When in my life have I left God out of the planning equation? What are some ways that I'm relying solely on my own effort and not God's will? Is there something I've recently felt challenged to surrender to God that I've been avoiding? Start your planning for tomorrow by surrendering today. It has a dual meaning that I hope you'll understand. First, we realize that surrender begins now. It begins on this day. There's no time better than now to give up the striving for control and choose surrender instead. It's not just a one-time decision to surrender. It's a continuous offering of your life to God's hands. And second, we surrender all parts of this day. Surrender of our life and will to God's control is an all-encompassing act. It means it's not something we do for just bits and pieces of our lives, but rather we surrender our lives as a whole. God wants the good, bad, and the ugly of your life. Why can we surrender today? Because the God of the universe provides for us. His provision is enough, and It's all that we need. When we begin to realize that we don't have to control and manipulate, that when we begin to understand that God's provision is enough for all that we need, that we don't need to earn God's love through our own effort, it begins to change everything. As I've given up that need to control my own life, I've learned new things. Things like that God will never love me more than He does at this moment. There's nothing I can do to make God love me more. Friend, there is nothing you can do to make God love you more than He does at this moment right now. No matter what you accomplish, no matter how badly you fail, His love for you will never change. I'm learning things like it doesn't take an accomplishment or a trophy to make God proud of me. God already is. He's so proud of you. Or that God's provision truly is more than enough. It's more than enough for me. It's more than enough for you. So as we surrender, why not surrender our lives and all parts of it as we consider tomorrow? So I carry that with me into the strange new reality that is stepping out of this church, out of the Illinois Great Rivers Conference, that I've been a part of since I was 14. Out of everything that I've ever known, as we follow what we believe is God's next adventure and calling to surrender for us at Grace Church in Southwest Florida. Am I nervous? Heavens yes. Am I scared? I'm terrified. Am I going to miss you all? More than I can put into words. Serving as your pastor for these past 5 years has been the honor of my life. Through a new build, through the highs and lows of a pandemic, through the highs and lows of congregational life as we've wept together over the death of dear friends and celebrated new births and members and baptisms and weddings. Through the simple joys of family life as you have taken my daughters as your own. You've watched Marky and Selah grow from toddlers to incredible girls and celebrated with us big time when Miss Evie came. You wept with me at the death of my father and in some of the hardest moments of my life. Friends, I could stay with you forever. My tomorrow was planned all around you. But planning for tomorrow means surrendering today. And God has asked us to surrender to this new path, trusting that He's provided in the past and will continue to provide in the future. And He's asking you to surrender to a new path with Andy as your lead pastor, trusting that God has guided this church in the past and will provide for all of your needs in the future. Planning for tomorrow means surrendering today. Because God has provided and will continue to provide. He is more than enough. He is more than enough. He is more than enough to handle our tomorrows. Pray with me. Lord, You hold our tomorrows in Your hands. The truth that we celebrate every Sunday when we gather together, that the tomb is empty, is what lets us know that You hold the future. That the worst things in our lives never have to be the last things. That there is always with You a better tomorrow. There is always with You a resurrection. There is always with You a putting back together if we would trust and obey. So help us to understand how much You love us, how proud You are of us, and how deeply You desire to be at the center of our planning. That we would not boast in our own schemes and our own plans for tomorrow, but that we would hold You at the center and allow You, Jesus, to be Lord and Master of our hearts. Be with us now as we turn to this table of Holy Communion and celebrate what You have done in holding our tomorrow. As You tore down the walls of sin and death and promised us provision. It's in your name, Lord Jesus, that we pray. Amen. Let's share together in this liturgy. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When our love failed and we turned away, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Will those who are helping to serve come forward? A few moments, the ushers will dismiss you to come forward for Holy Communion from the side aisles. You'll be given a piece of bread, dip it into the cup. In the Wesleyan tradition, we celebrate an open table of communion. That means anyone who's seeking deeper relationship with Jesus is welcome to receive the sacrament, whether you're a member of this church or not. Jesus is the one who calls us to this table. You return to your seats by the center aisle and remain in an attitude of prayer until all are served.